transportation is the single largest source of greenhouse gas emissions in the United States. Efforts to reduce transportation emissions in the long run aim to transition away from gasoline and diesel fuels to alternative fuels. Of course, alternative fuels have greenhouse gas emissions too. For example, when I drive my electric vehicle, there are no tailpipe emissions, but when I charge it, emissions from power plants that supply the electricity increase. To understand the full emissions effect of a transition to alternative fuels, it's important to consider all of the emissions across the supply chain over the full life cycle. Scientists call this life cycle analysis. Regulators use life cycle analysis in their work, either as a way to assign emissions intensities to different fuels, or as a way to check to make sure that a proposed policy intended to reduce emissions will actually reduce emissions over the life cycle. Over the past year, I've worked with a committee at the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine to develop a consensus report on methods used for life cycle analysis. These consensus reports bring together experts from universities, industry, government, and nonprofit organizations to discuss current research. And though experts disagree on a lot of things, consensus reports help establish which issues can be considered settled science. Among the most important findings in the report are that there are fundamentally different kinds of life cycle assessment designed to answer fundamentally different questions. Sometimes you'll hear on the news that electric vehicles are clean, and then later you'll hear that they aren't so clean, and you might wonder why different studies are producing different answers. One of the key reasons is that sometimes they ask different questions. There are two main types of life cycle assessment, each designed to answer a different question: attributional life cycle assessment and consequential life cycle assessment. In an attributional assessment, researchers ask, what part of global emissions should be assigned to a product? We count up all of the emissions we observe, including from greenhouse gas emissions and other factors, and decide which emissions should be attributed to which products or activities. This can be complicated. For example, refineries produce gasoline, but they also produce diesel, jet fuel, plastic precursors, and other products at the same time. Attributional assessments need to make decisions about how much of the refinery's emissions each product is accountable for. In a consequential assessment, the relevant question is, what is the change in global emissions resulting from a change in the production or use of a product? For example, researchers might assess how the emissions from the power system will change if we transition away from gasoline vehicles toward electric vehicles. This can also be complicated because researchers need to predict what a future scenario might look like with this additional electric vehicle charging compared to without it. Our report found that it is critically important to use the right tool for the right question. Each approach has its place and can provide helpful information in the right context. In particular, we recommend that any public policy intending to reduce emissions should ensure that the consequential life cycle impact of the proposed policy is likely to reduce net emissions and increase net benefits to society. That means policymakers need to assess what emissions would look like with and without the policy to ensure that it will reduce emissions and do so in a way that benefits society on balance. Our report addresses key issues ranging from life cycle assessment fundamentals and use in public policy, consideration of uncertainty, methods for verification, and specific issues with life cycle assessment of gasoline and diesel, biofuels, electricity, and other fuels.